All right. Well, welcome. Welcome to Let's Talk Church Health. The subtitle is, Dean realized that there were people not going to be on committees and that we should have something that they should be able to do, and called Bob and said, do something. That's the subtitle to this. So, people will be pouring in now. So what we'd like to do, the people who are on the stage here are the part of the National Church Health Team. We're missing Michael and Jim Farrell, but this is the group of people who form our national team and have been helping us put together the strategy for what we're doing. And if you're one of our coordinators, could you stand up just so they know who those people are? So we have 14 of them somewhere. Well, Mike Gibson is not here, so this is the group. So what I really want to get to is if there are, thanks guys. So if there are some of you who would like to meet your coordinator, to talk with them, to encourage them, to pray for them, or to say, hey, I really want to help. How can I help you? That would be a great, great gift. But we'll just, so you can see how formal this is going to be, right? So why don't we just start with, if you have questions about evangelism or transitional pastoring or church health or the resourcing structure we're kind of building up, and questions about what that might look like in your presbytery or just kind of whatever comes to mind, we are happy to try and answer some questions. So, you do. Okay. Can we, for real, can we turn, is there a way to turn those lights off? Uh-oh, somebody's moving. Look out. Down, off, anything would be good. I've had 160 lasers in my eyes. This is not my friend.
Phone call the other day during the presentation about the three E's, and I've been hearing this discussed repeatedly, and I'm wondering if you're going to run back over that today.
The three circles?
Three circles, I mean, yes.
Yeah. So here's our plan currently, which could change now. Our plan was that we were going to, at first we thought we'd do that here, then we realized there might be a whole number of you who did it Tuesday morning. So when we break up with coordinators, we were going to ask the coordinator to just check the group and see if they'd had, check with the group to see if we've done that. So we're going to try to do it in the group. So our coordinators are kind of on alert with the folks. So we will find somebody who will do it and make sure that you know that.
Will it be on the website?
It is, yes. So if you go, this is a great question. So we discovered that evangelism was not even on the EPC website. And considering that we're the, you get it, right? That this was something we needed to remedy. So currently, if you go to epc.org, I see all you computer people and phone people. If you go to epc.org and look under the resources, what we do tab, there's a tab that says what we do. If you hit that, the first thing that will come up now is evangelism. And so if you hit that, there's something, there will be kind of a what we were calling before a preamble. Because what we really wanted to do was put the three circles in an EPC context so that it made sense kind of in our language, in our way. And some of you who were, how many were you there Tuesday morning? Okay, pretty good number. So those of you who heard Jimmy on Tuesday morning heard him say about 20 times, this is an open source tool, which is great. So he kind of allowed us to, he said, make this as EPC as you want to make it, whatever that means. And so rather than doing a lot of work in terms of changing the tool, because that would mean we'd have to change a lot of resources, all those kind of things, we built in an EPC preamble. So that's the first thing that will come up. If you go to epc.org, what we do, evangelism, then you'll see some writing that describes why this is compatible with who we are as a denomination. Then under that is Jimmy doing a, it's a video of Jimmy doing the three circle, a presentation of the three circles. So that is on our website now. Soon we will be adding some other things, including our transitional pastor material and some other things that we're just now building out, but that will go on the website as well. So,
could I add one thing to the three circles?
You can add 100 things.
I actually just had a question from a ruling elder on the way out who's in our presbytery about, you know, where do I find the three circles information? And the website is the first place to go. There's also the book, Turning Everyday Conversations into Gospel Conversations, which everyone who was there Tuesday got a copy of. That's really, that's the whole deal right there. So if you have that book, it's a helpful book because, you know, people always have questions about, okay, I get the three circles, but how do I transition to the three circles when I'm in a conversation with someone? Or, you know, how do I move to an invitation? And so the book gives language to that, and it's helpful. The third thing I would say is that there's also a church kit through the North American Mission Board of the Southern Baptist denomination. And if you Google Three Circles Church Kit, it will lead you there as well. I used that in a Sunday school in January, and what I really liked about it, if you have the book, you have everything. But what I liked about the church kit is that it broke it down over the course of 6 weeks, and there are teachings by Jimmy each week. But the thing that's really good about it is that it helps you think through, you know, as Presbyterians, we're so good with information that we don't do great at practice a lot of times. And so we give information, and then we kind of sometimes assume people will just know what to do with this. And the thing about walking through it with a group of people for 6 weeks is that there's accountability there to say, let's not just learn this here in Sunday school because that's the easy part, but let's pray about the three people that that the Lord's bringing to our mind to share this material with, and then let's look for the opportunities to do that, and then let's actually do that, and then next week we can report on how those things went. Where did the Holy Spirit open up those conversations? And so I found that that's a really effective way at the congregational level to really begin engaging our people in not only knowing about the three circles, but actually practicing them. So the church kit is a helpful thing. It's not required by any means, but it's just helpful.
A couple other quick resources. We mentioned it the other day, but a reminder that there is a student ministry kit and there is a children's ministry kit that teach your students and children how to use it, so that's available as well. The other thing I wanted to say that I lost track of the other day, was if anybody wants the PowerPoint that Jimmy and Todd used, minus the pictures of the family. Well, you can keep the one with my grandchildren in, but the other one we don't care about. If you'd like the PowerPoint presentation to use at your church as a way of sharing what it means to be an evangelistic, creating an evangelistic culture, we can get that PowerPoint to you as well. It's what's Jim's email address? JimFarrell54 at Gmail. Or ask one of us, we can get it sent to you. But it's a great tool to present some of the, starting with praying and the 10 things that they did. So that's available, it's open source for us. So if that's helpful for you presenting to your church or a class or whatever, then that's great. The one story that sticks with me is last time I saw, you saw the picture of our grandchildren, Cade is the oldest. So I walked in the door, I hadn't seen him for a while. He said, "Hi, Pap, how are you doing?" I said, "I'm great, Cade, how are you?" He said, "Do you know Jesus?" I'm like, is this a trick question? I said, "Cade, you know what I do?" He said, "Well, not all pastors are Christians." All right, fair enough. Why would you ask me that? He said, "I just want to share with you three circles." And as a 7-year-old, outlined the whole process with the scriptures in and all that. And he said, is there any reason why you wouldn't make this decision now? Like, well, Cade, sort of did a long time. I was on the defensive the whole time. Cade was after me. Because that day, he had gone to his school, And they had show and tell. His show and tell was the three circles for his class. It's just powerful demonstration of how usable, adaptable, simple that it is. So,
Bruce? One other thing
that I think you need to realize is we're talking about a tool, and it's a good tool, but tools often get used a little bit and then get put on the shelf. So in addition to providing this simple approach, it also gives you ideas and methodology to make it part of your church culture. And I think that as it relates to all church health things, that's what we're trying to do, give churches a process to develop a culture that will survive as things change. And so those are the real, for me, the real interesting parts of the three circles, is that it helps the church get it into every aspect of church life.
And if you just Google three circles, there are people from all over the world doing deep dive studies on the different parts of it and how to present it in different ways and what the implications are, which in my mind kind of mucks it up a little bit. But if that's helpful to you, there's all kinds of things if you ask Rabbi Google. So, yes.
Is this working? Hi. I'm Rick Dietzman. I'm from the Pacific Northwest, teaching elder. Actually, I've had the chance to teach three circles a couple times in the last few weeks, one to an alpha group at the very end, which was really fun.
Perfect.
About sharing with others. I taught it to men's Bible study on Saturday morning last week, and I also taught it in a God Space class, which is Doug Pollock's thing on how to, you know, start conversations. But I had a question. Has there been some discussion about what do you do when you start seeing people that are responding to that in your church? What's the follow-on to that? Say, you know, alpha's an easy one to think about, but anything like that, has that been discussed in the church health team?
Well, so I would say, obviously, it's different for every context and situations. So the way that Family Church does it, if you remember Todd talking about First Connections, so every one Sunday a month, everybody who has visited the church or is new to the church goes to a First Connections, which is a sort of get-to-know-you sort of thing. But at the heart of it is people trained with the three circles. So then they follow that up with every 3 months they do for everybody who has, it's either 3 months or 2 months, anyway, whatever it is, they do a class kind of bringing all those people together. Okay, where are you? Where are you stuck? You know, I went out and tried to share it, and I got lost between two and three. And so that's a good follow-up to that. But I think something like that, and they're, again, their First Connection stuff, so Todd is one of the pastors at Sherbrooke. They'll get like 40 people a month coming to this thing. And about half of them make a commitment to Christ right there on the spot. So they have big numbers, and I know your church and situation may be smaller, but I think the important thing is, where do you connect with first-time visitors and new people, and then how do you help them connect with the life of the church? So it's kind of a two-step process, First Connections, and then the thing that they do to take all of those people and integrate them into the life of the church. So Alpha is a perfect, I mean, there's all kinds of, I think it's a tremendous tool for Alpha. It might look different for you, but my recommendation is there's immediate opportunities for people to hear the gospel, and then there's a way to connect those people over a small period of time to get them more integrated into the life of the church. Yes, so if you go to familychurch dot something, family.
Family.church.
Anyway, Family Church West Palm Beach, if you ask Rabbi Google, probably get you there. But they have all kinds of resources. So you saw the prayer cards that they had. They have all kinds of resources and flyers that they've already done that are perfect for this environment. So, and again, open source, take it, contextualize it, use part of it, make it a little bit different. I know Stefan has done some things with kind of making it
usable for him?
Yeah, good. Yeah, sure, go ahead. Yep.
I have a lot of experience doing classes like Alpha, and I would recommend, yes, in addition to this, this is kind of a one-off evangelism, right? Someone makes a decision. Most people are not ready to jump into your new members class where you teach them about Presbyterianism, the Westminster Confession of Faith, right? Like, that's a big jump, right? Like, brokenness, Westminster. So I think some sort of pre-membership class is a great idea. Some I would commend to you would be the Alpha Course, Christianity Explained or Christianity Explored as a starting point. Anything that's process-oriented, relational, and you'll find some people who are uncomfortable with direct evangelism, maybe door-to-door, walk-up evangelism, beach, you know, that will love the Alpha Course because it's super non-threatening, super relational. Maybe the women can make the pasta every week or something. So it's another way to mobilize the whole church in evangelism. If you're not sure where to schedule it, put it so that it ends right before your new members class starts, right? So it's a feeder. Or have it launch right after Christmas and Easter because that's when all of your guests come. And have an Alpha testimony or a testimony of somebody who came to Christ at those services and then launch like right after in January, right after Easter. Those are great solutions to kind of keep that process going.
And a quick reminder, while Mike's coming, a quick reminder that they take the approach that if somebody has walked into their church, they're fair game. They've opened themselves to this possibility. And again, they have people who don't, you know, engage or only come once or whatever, but they're all in on, if they've shown up, we're going to do our very best to have them hear the gospel and get them integrated into the life of the church. So, Mike?
So I'm Mike Griffin from Presbytery of the Pacific Southwest, and echoing some of the things that Stefan said, what we developed was something called Sierra Press Next Steps. And so that was an invitation to a meal following a Sunday. And it basically, like he said, it came after Christmas, it came after Easter. It was about a month before our membership class. It was a meal, it was very low, you know, I mean, just connectional time, but we did share the three circles there. And we basically outlined our discipleship process at Sierra Press and invited people into that. And so, you know, having that kind of connectional time immediately after Easter, we're not a huge church, but we had 20 people that had come to Easter Sunday, come to the Next Steps meal the following Sunday. A number of those people did come to our membership class. It gave us an opportunity to share the gospel. If you go through, you know, a revitalization process with one of the coordinators and the way we would coach you through that, we would help you develop a discipleship process. So a Next Steps type of thing would feed into an entry-level type experience like Alpha or into groups and help you look at how your church is arranged and has a discipleship process that you can extend a good invitation for people into. So that's part of what we do in a revitalization process, not only creating those doorways or entry points, but really help you look at, okay, you've got this outward focus, you want to connect with new people, but once they're there, like Rick asked, where are you going to draw them in, and how are you going to build them up, let's say. So that's part of what we do in connecting those things.
And if you remember one of the points in the 10 points of the presentation, this bottleneck idea has, aside from the material itself, has been kind of the most revolutionary thing, at least in my thinking, that no matter where you create bottlenecks in your church, where there are opportunities to present the three circles, so marriage counseling, weddings, any kids advancing, youth ministry stuff, camps, vacation Bible school, wherever there are points in your church that people are naturally pushed into and through creating a bottleneck, anywhere you have those opportunities to kind of present the three circles, those are great, great opportunities that people are naturally moving through to hear that. So those are, that's a super important point. So, yes.
Hi, I'm Steve Richley, senior pastor at Sunset Presbyterian Church in Portland, Oregon. And our session went through the leadership guide and we got to chapter 15. Do we still use the natural church development tool? And is there any way we can access those tools or help in that area?
Yeah. So I was a natural, NCD, National Church Development. I was a regional director for that for a number of years. And so yes, it can be used. For me, the limiting factor was kind of, so for those of you who aren't familiar with NCD, there is 8 quality characteristics that define a healthy church. And then their position is that being aware of what those staves are, like the stave on a barrel, wherever the lowest one is, that's where your energy and resources are going to pour out. And so you work over time to improve what's called your minimum factor. And that over time, you're constantly working on your minimum factor and get better. And they have lots of resources and all of that. My takeaway from that after all those years is I think it's a great assessment tool. I think it's much harder to use in terms of ongoing ministry. So if it's, I think it's helpful in being another tool in the drawer for a self-assessment kind of thing. But I think it's much harder to make simple and implementable. Is that a word?
Implementable.
Yeah, for a church. So sure, there's all kinds of things out there to be able to use. And there's no reason not to use it. But it's just harder to move forward with in the church health process. So, Andy? Okay, the question was, or the comment was, to comment about our resourcing structure and now how we're talking about coordinators and coaches. Again, as I shared in the report, for me, the question is, how do we get someone, the primary question that I think makes the lasting difference is how do we get someone next to the church? How do we get someone who can really help a church take resources but apply it in their context? So this may shock you, but almost every church is different. It's not enough to just say, hey, here's a resource, good luck with that. We really need someone to get alongside that person. So ultimately the coaching component is the place where we think we'll make a difference. But in order to get those coaches, we need to have people who identify them and train them and make it applicable to their presbytery, which is our coordinators that you just met. And Jeff is a coordinator too in Puddles and Ponds or whatever that, what's that? Yeah, Rivers and Lakes, yeah. So we need coordinators to be able to identify those coaches, train them, get them close to the church. Our role is to feed the coordinators. So for lasting change, coaching is what has an impact in my judgment. Because it's easy to take the stuff, go home and go, whoa, wait a second, we got lost somewhere in the shuffle, and then it just kind of moves off if somebody's not there to kind of contextualize it. And you guys comment?
You can see what's happening even in the room, and it's the most exciting thing to me because now there's a structure and a group of people that meet regularly in our coordinators, and as they identify those coaches, they'll be closer, like you were saying, even to the churches. But the synergy that happens, and if Michael were here, he'd talk about the collaboration, just to have our coaches or our coordinators be able to stand up and say, oh wait, this is what I've been doing, and they get to hear one another say that, and then you get the benefit of that, the best practices kind of thing. So church health has a nice avenue that's being created for the flow of information and for the collaboration that's going to make the difference, because there are things that are already working in our churches around the country and even around the world, and we have a way to collect those now and to share those with everybody, and then you'll find one that works in your context too. So again, the most exciting thing to me are the people that are pouring their efforts into this. Some have been doing that for a very long time, and now again has a good team of support to continue that work, so I'm excited about that.
Can I just say something? I am a coach, and Bob has helped train me to be a coach, and we have several coaches in our presbytery, so I kind of oversee the other coaches. So once you get moving in that direction, you'll see that each coach has a certain winding that might fit. This coach might be better in a small church, rural area. This coach would be better in a larger church in a more urban area. And you get to develop the differences so that they really can contextualize it and it fits who they are. And we found in doing that, not only is it helpful to get the church actually to do something. But it makes them feel like, hey, I really can use this stuff, as opposed to, that doesn't apply to me, or I don't know how to use it. And the coaches then begin to share with each other what they're experiencing at different levels. And maybe this goes beyond what we want to talk about here, but inevitably you're going to find that there's other issues in churches that need to be worked on, improved, and so you can bring those back to other elements in your presbytery that might be able to come alongside those churches. So it finally mushrooms into other areas of church health.
And one other comment, just hearing Bruce speak. Bruce is a ruling elder from a church and had lots of experience in business and great leadership skills. What we really want to do is help our coordinators identify those people who might, they have life principles, they're leaders, they're out in front of things. How can we equip them to do the coaching kind of thing? So it's super important for those of you who are here, and if you have time to gather around your coordinator a little bit, you know, some of you may be in this room like, I could coach. Well, great. Get up next to your coordinator and let's begin to talk about developing a system. I mean, if we think of the power of each of us, each of our presbyteries, having a coordinator and 10 coaches. Think of the difference we could really make coming alongside these churches who are willing to look at changes. So it's the expression, fly the plane while you're building it. We're kind of doing that, but God's been out in front of it. And, you know, I have to say to our coordinators, I'm so grateful for the people God's brought to us. It's amazing. And we're very excited about the future. So, yes.
Todd Paulson, ruling elder, Sartell, Presbytery of the Pebbles and Ponds, or Rivers and Lakes.
Yeah, wherever that is. Yeah. Jeff's place, that's what we call it. Yeah.
I'm just wondering if there is such a thing as a job description for coach.
Yes.
Church coach. Okay.
Yes, we have a ministry description for coordinators, ministry descriptions for coaches, what that looks like. So again, there are situations where we have some folks, coaches retired in the Alleghenies, that they're doing 2 and 3 churches that are, you know, kind of close to their house and stuff and enjoying that. But yes, we do have a coach's description, coordinator's descriptions available, so yeah.
And the advantage now of the way this is set up and structured is you've got an access point through your coordinator at almost each presbytery.
Almost there.
The value of that is those coordinators can call the National Church Health Leadership Team, and all of us have networks of folks we've worked with. So if we don't have an answer for how to attack a problem or implementation, we know who to call to get you there. And we can help make that very practical and real. That's something we haven't had in the past.
Okay, good. I'll tell you guys a little story. In September, I took a leadership class at Fuller on transformative leadership, and the project was to form a group, a holding group of leaders, and help them transform a bit. And I'm involved in my presbytery in Pacific Northwest doing missions, and we've been doing this for quite a while with missions leaders, gathering them, trying to get them interested in various projects in world outreach. But I'm also a discipleship pastor, associate pastor at my church. And I realized that I had not really extended that kind of a network to the discipleship small groups, even evangelism-oriented people. There were several that were directors in the churches that never came to presbytery. In the smaller churches, there's sometimes an elder in charge of that. They come, but maybe there's somebody else. So there was a lot of people that are, you know, below what the senior pastor is, who are working on these kinds of things, evangelism, missions too, but not really linked in. And so my project was, I started this in September, was to go to every single of our 40 pastors and say, hey, who is the discipleship person in your church? Or who's working on evangelism, outreach, small groups, anything like that, alpha, you know, the oriented, you know, how do you help people go to the next step? Who's working on that? What do you have going? Ask those questions. Fascinating study. And it turns out it's like the parable of the soils. you get about, out of the 40, 10 didn't want to talk to me. 10 were very excited, but I never heard from them again. 10 that were like, yeah, and then got distracted. And then I got 10 right off the bat who were excited and ready to go. So that was interesting in itself in the coaching. And then actually out of that too, I found, ooh, there's probably some coaches in this last quarter of the people that are fruitful already and doing things. It was interesting because I've been working on this for 4 months now. I did the paper several months ago, but I've been at two Presbyterian meetings, had two Zoom calls, tried to really do this as a project and write a paper for a doctor of ministry class. And what I found that has happened is in that first fruitful group, they're now expanding their sphere of influence dramatically into the others, especially the distracted. And in fact, even in the cold shoulder group, I went to my third presbytery after this, I was getting people that said, yeah, you know, you asked me that question 2 months ago, and I got a person now assigned to discipleship. They want to talk to you. So just a fascinating thing. Is this happening in the rest of the denomination at any level? Sort of like, you know, you hear about church planting and how they're doing five churches 5 years ago and now whatever, 37 it was, and they have a network and all this cohorts. Is that happening in other presbyteries where these kinds of cohorts among the discipleship, small groups, alpha process, whatever, could we even see that happen? Wouldn't that be cool?
It would be cool. Yeah, and I think that's probably a likely role for our coordinators. So our coordinators are all recently on board, and we're just kind of rolling this out. But to Rick's point, I think a lot of the work of the coordinators will be kind of digging into their presbytery, doing the kinds of work that Rick is doing and talking about there. So as they kind of get on the ground and start doing these things, those are exactly the kind of things that our coordinators are going to be looking for, and who the coaches are and all that's involved in that. Brandon.
Yeah, I'll speak to it briefly, then I'll pass it to you. I'm just a little better looking. It's okay, though. No, I was going to say about cohorts, one thing we've done.
And who are you?
You say what? Oh, yeah, I'm Brandon Addison, sorry. Church Health Coordinator, Presbytery of the West, teaching elder there. One thing that we've done is Duke Divinity and Leadership gave us a grant, and so we're actually going to pilot an adaptive leadership cohort for pastors in the West. Spend the first 3 months doing like emotional intelligence training. The next 3 months do bring your adaptive leadership to the cohort, and the idea is, can we get ahead to do some revitalization of the leader before we hit bottom and things like that. So if you know the leaders, primarily the Presbytery of the West, five states, big category, please come talk to me. That'll launch in about 4 months. So, thank you.
Awesome sauce. And who are you?
There it is. Okay, great. Chris Greenwood, coordinator for Coastal Mid-Atlantic, teaching elder. Bob, I was going to give you a question, actually. I'm a high bar guy. And I think this is a great moment for us in the church health arena. If you can lay out a definition for what you consider kind of the pinnacle healthy church, what does a healthy church actually look like? Just kind of give us a mental picture of the preeminent healthy church. And don't shy away from it. Don't give, you know, just... like, this is what every church needs to aspire to be, because this is what God would expect of a healthy church. What would that look like to you?
What's that? Yeah, Acts 2. Yeah. So I guess my initial response would be it's summarized kind of in the mission statement of the denomination, that a healthy church is a Great Commission church, who's living out its values in terms of being Reformed, Presbyterian, Evangelical, and missional. And when those components are held together in the context of the Great Commission, you may not be doing everything, but you're probably a pretty healthy church, at least in the context of the EPC. Because we could, I mean, it's obviously the kind of the starting point question, what are we aiming for? But I think the denomination has given us kind of a vision of what that can be and what it can look for. I know for sure one thing is a healthy church is seeing people come to Jesus. We can argue about a lot of stuff, but that's part of what it means to be a healthy church. Yes.
Hi, Becky Hi. Schultz with Families Alive, Presbytery of the West. When I think of healthy churches, I think of the people of the churches and the families of the churches. Is there a plan for evangelism in the home, spreading from parents, grandparents to the next generation that way?
Throw me out there. Okay, so I would say, I think our plan revolves around kind of what we just talked about, that if, in the context of the three circles, we already have built into the process, parents obviously learning what they're doing, a student ministry's opportunity to do it, a children's kit for how to do it. At Family Church, what they do is every child after second grade, they go through the three circles as part of their process of moving toward membership and baptism in their context. And so they're very intentional, starting at six years old, doing that. So they put together whole kits for that, so that it is a part of what happens in the whole home. Is that kind of what you're asking? I don't want to miss your question.
That's part of it.
Yep.
And then do we have a plan for equipping parents also to continue?
Yes. Amen. Yep. And I think that's the importance of the bottleneck conversation, that at every point in the life of the church, somebody's running up against, almost no matter what you do or where you go, you're going to run up against three circles. So that it's really in grace. So I think they use the illustration of, their summer camp. Well, all the people who volunteered to go to the summer camp, some are parents of those kids. Well, they're going to be trained in the three circles before they go. So that if you're looking for those bottlenecks in the life of the church, over actually a relatively short period of time, almost everybody in the church is going to hit up against it somewhere. And that they're doing it, again, with their children's ministry, they're doing it with their youth ministry. So at every level and at every bottleneck, it's present. So it's hard to miss. I guess you could, but you'd have to work at it.
I would also like to add, I think it's important, I agree with you 100%, that it's important for parents to be part of the nurturing of their children to Jesus. And too often churches allow parents to abdicate that responsibility by having too many in-house programs for each age group. But each church is different. So I would simply encourage the churches to use the tools that are available and say, here, parents, we're going to have a class for you to learn how to share this with your children. And most churches have vows that they take, the parents take when they have baptism, the church vows to help these parents. We need to uphold those vows. And so leadership of churches need to not so much hold people accountable, but to encourage parents by follow-up. How are you doing in using the three circles with Billy and Susie at the supper table? How are you doing this as a family? So it would just be simple ways to adapt that depending on the church setting. So, we're not here to say this is exactly what you have to do as a church. These are tools and processes adapted to your setting. That's why coaches is helpful.
Right, and so then there's another component to that, and the component is the next step. So how are you going to equip your parents to continue to nurture their children in faith, right? And there has to be serious thought and planning given to that.
Right. Here's what excites me as a small church pastor when I look at the three circles. It gives common language, not only to the church, but to the family. And so as you're building a culture of evangelism, it's also a culture of transformation and a culture of sanctification. And because you can go back to that over and over again, and if you're familiar with childhood education, you circle back around, and every time it means more and more. And that happens not only in the culture of the life of the church, but the culture of the life of your family, and you're not going in 100 different directions. You're going, okay, this means something new to you at this new stage in your life, and that works in the family. So for me, that's how I'll be using it as a pastor with families in my church. Yeah.
Bob? Go ahead, Bob, while we're waiting for them.
I'm guessing the question behind the question a little bit too, right, is like parents' responsibilities to their children versus passing it off to the church. I think it's important when we talk about evangelism, there's this debate between, is evangelism an event or is it a process, right? And we were wrestling with that with Alpha. For example, I shared three circles, I'm done. Well, you're just getting started. And I think the strength of three circles is it's a great way to get the conversation started. It's a, like it's the epitome of event evangelism. It's like three circles in 3 minutes. But like the Bible's a really thick book and our kids are really young people, right? But that's where I think the strength of three circles is that. But obviously we have Westminster Confession of Faith. We have our catechisms. Like, how do we train kids in the Westminster Confession? I don't know. There's an ancient thing called a catechism. But so we have other tools. And I think we're not abandoning our other resources. And I think parents should lean into, obviously, Bible reading, using Westminster, and all the other things. I think the strength, personally, of three circles is how do I share the gospel with my coworker, or how do I take the youth group out on the beach? You know, that's where it's going to be really, really strong. Or these bottlenecks, like we got a bunch of people in. How do we, within 30 minutes, really make the gospel really clear? But when it comes to your families, yeah, if every week at family devotions I'm sharing three circles, my kids are going to say like, hey, Dad, anything else? You know, so yeah, there's some limits to three circles being the full comprehensive discipleship package, if that's what you're implying.
Yeah, absolutely.
And
absolutely. So, I think the part that we're after too is you're hearing a lot of emphasis from us related to evangelism and transitional pastors because there's a crisis in our church related to those two areas. We haven't been outwardly focused as well as we should. My presbytery, 9 of our 32 churches are without a lead pastor right now. So you're hearing a lot about evangelism and transitional pastors. The third spoke, if we've got three spokes, is church health. And it's our discipleship process, I think, is our church health. So for me, when I got in touch with Bob in this process, they helped me develop a discipleship process when it's included family ministry, teaching our families how to do a family devotional time, which I learned on the mission field, you know, in Morocco from a missionary family that knew how to do this through YouTube, didn't need the organ, didn't need the, you know, this. They played a YouTube video, the same song, and the kids were worshiping, and Jesus was present. And so we brought that model home with our families and taught that. So that's really the third spoke. If we have three spokes, is church health, and we teach people how to develop a discipleship process within your church. And so we have that tool in our belt. You're hearing a lot about evangelism and church and transitional pastors right now because I think they're an immediate priority. But the third part and the heart really is church health and church health and discipleship.
And if I could add just one last piece to that. So I think with the coaches and the coordinators, we're at a place where, you know, we've said we're kind of building the scaffolding, but at the same time, we have a toolbox full of assessment tools. We have a toolbox full of, you know, how do you lead a congregation through a process of discipleship? And, you know, in our monthly calls together, in our biannual gatherings together, we're talking about these things. You know, what is, you know, we have an endorsed resource now for, you know, for evangelism, three circles. We don't have an endorsed resource for what the next step of that is. Right. Maybe that's something that we need to talk about. But we've heard about some of them today. The same is true with family ministries. You know, maybe, well, family's alive. There's a toolbox. There's a tool for the toolbox that all of our coordinators now across our whole denomination can learn about, know about, and be able to recommend to churches, you know, as those churches are thinking about what does family discipleship mean. So I think, you know, I think the short answer to your question way back was, as a national lead team, no, we don't have a strategy for helping parents disciple their children. But yes, we have a scaffolding for that whole conversation to happen. And right now we're in this mode of, as this thing is growing, finding and discovering these resources that as the EPC, we can just say, hey, you, as a church, looks like you need some family discipleship help here. Here's some of our own people doing this. You need to check that out. So we're equipping ourselves as well as churches right now.
Bob? So it's hard to get in here. My name is Bob White, and Presbyterian of the Alleghenies. I am in process of being ordained. But you guys pretty much answered my question, which evangelism is the first step of discipleship. How much does the church health network, how much is that dealing with discipleship? And so I don't know if there's any more to be said, but that's functionally what I wanted to get at, and we kind of already got there.
Bill?
Yeah, so to go back to this, you can be stealthy using these tools. So one of the churches I served had a preschool by design. I did faith development with the preschoolers up to kindergarten. So every week I'm seeing those kids, I'm teaching them faith lessons. A short half page is going home with them that outlines what they learned, and by design at the end there's one additional question. So my parents, who aren't Christian or aren't mature Christians, hit that question in conversation with their kids, right, where they're walking through this, and if they don't know the answer, then I get calls. Now I have an entry point into a faith dialogue with that parent or parents. So you can be sneaky about creating those doorways that allow you to share gospel, or to invite folks into deeper discipleship.
And just to speak to Bob's question a little bit, we have a process for helping a church think about, connect about how they move outside their walls to connect with their community, engage in a discipleship process that is associated with that. So yes, we do have that as well in our church health process.
I really take this off. I really do like Three Circles, especially in comparison to something like Evangelism Explosion, which I've been through, and it's so, you have to feel like you're a seminary professor to kind of go through it. And hope to see it implemented in some ways within our church after Fern finished the sermon series on the church itself and up on outreach. And we have a coffee house ministry that I'm hoping and praying by around that time it would be something that I would envision it to be. Right now it just needs some work, but it's getting there. And the reason is because I don't want to hammer our people, you need to do this, you need to do this, without providing an opportunity, an outlet for them to do that. Kind of sort of train them there and then send them out into the world. My only thing about the Three Circles, though, is that, and I apologize for being a troublemaker, but just within that basic thing theologically, there's not a wrath of God that's there. You have sin and brokenness in the gospel, which is all very true and all need to be covered, but through that process of doing that, I'll probably add God's wrath and so forth. That is within the group that put out Three Circles, that is within their training things. It's just not, you know, the very basic stuff that's there. So again, I apologize for being a troublemaker.
Yeah, and I appreciate it, Brent. You know, you're not a troublemaker. Well, you are a troublemaker, but not in this context. I would say this, so first it's open sourced. So if you feel like that's an important ingredient of sharing, then share it. The thing they are very concerned about is making it so complex and remembering so many things that you lose the part of the power of simplicity. So again, they're so adamant about being open sourced if there's a part of it. So everybody's going to use it a little differently. We've already, so even as you think about the Three Circles, I've heard it 100 times now. Well, I start with brokenness. Well, I start with God's design. Well, I start with the gospel. I don't care where you start. just use it. It's all it's intended to do is be a visual map of the things that are important. So I would say even the line between brokenness and the gospel, they talk about repent and believe. The language most often people I hear use is turn and trust. But what are we turning from? We're turning from our brokenness, which brings on the wrath of God, which goes back to the sin component. So it's easily put in there if that's, you know, something that's good to you. But they make, hearing Jimmy and Todd tell stories is funny because, you know, somebody came to them with a 10-circle version of an adaptation that they thought they needed to get in there for somebody to, they're not going to get the Westminster Confession from the three circles. I mean, there's a couple of jumps in there that need to happen. And so I completely understand what you're saying, and it would be easily put in if that's something that's important to you in the context. They're just trying to keep it simple, adaptable, visual, usable. And that somebody who is impacted by hearing the three circles can immediately turn around. It's what they call the rapid obedience part, can immediately turn around and share it again. So the harder you make it, the more difficult it is for them to turn around and use it. So again, open source, use it how you want. They would say, if you're sharing the gospel, great. So
I was saying, I like the simplicity of it, because if you wanted to interject the wrath of God even, it's so relatable that if God created everything and it was good and he loved it and then someone ruined it, that would make you angry. And that plays even with like a kindergarten kid. You know what I mean? So that's the simplicity of it. You can plug that in anywhere you need to, but it's an appropriate part of it. Yeah.
Well, good. So I'm sure there's still lots of questions, but I would like to take an opportunity for you to get to know your coordinator. Not all of our coordinators are here, but many of them are here. So if you're in the room from one of the presbyteries represented, would love you to get to know your coordinator. What's the best way to do this? I don't even know.
Stand up and identify yourselves and kind of
let's make a regional map of the United States in here.
Okay, yeah, just come to the mic and tell them where you're
from. All right, so I'm Stefan, Presbytery of the East, and I will meet in that back corner.
There you go. Ron Horgan. Over here from Gulf South. Okay, you can be in that corner, Ron.
Okay. Mike Griffin, Presbytery Pacific Southwest. I will be right over here.
I'm Brandon Addison, Presbytery of the West. I'll be in that middle section over there.
Chris Greenwood again. I'm tired of Brandon always going in front of me.
Over here.
I'll be in the back right corner, coastal. If you're mid-Atlantic and your person's not here, I know Brian's here, but I think Andy had to leave.
Andy had to leave.
So you can go either with Brian or with me.
Bill is going to take Andy's group.
Okay, fantastic. Well, just coastal mid-Atlantic, back right corner, right over here.
So Bill is going to take New River Presbytery.
Mark Farrell, Florida Caribbean Presbytery, and we'll be right over here.
All right, I'm over here in Bryan Land, Central Carolinas. We're going to meet at the Cigar Lounge. No, I'll be right here.
Richie Cable, Mid-America. We're going to be out there in the lobby area, right there, just outside the doors.
Andy Gilman, Andy. Midwest. We can just be right up in front right here.
And Jeff Moore, Rivers and Lakes, right here in the front.
Corner.
If your coordinator is not here and you'd like to have some more conversations, Bruce and I are up here for those not affiliated.